couldn't stop looking at it. I think at one point I was making sure my bus weren't coming so I could read each one.
The questions fundamentally get you thinking about decision-making and autonomy, where actually the ground is very uncertain and unstable. It was very particular to place it on this kind of boundary where the kind of mental health hospital interacts with the real, you know, outside world.
One morning I was walking into work and I noticed that there was something different about the signs. Because of the direction that I was coming from, the first letter that I saw was an I. And then I saw an N.
A friend called me one morning and said, did I know about the graffiti outside Bethlem?
We managed to get some photos sent, and it was clear that this was much more than just a bit of graffiti, and I didn't want it cleaned off at all.
I didn't know the story. That's part of the problem, isn't it? Someone who, I guess, has a certain knowledge of the history of the hospital and has worked here, I didn't know that story. Why is that?
I said, wow, they haven't forgotten Shaney. That person knew that Shaney had died at that hospital. Somebody knew that he was a young black man. Somebody knew what had happened to him, and they weren't going to let the moment pass.
When I saw the graffiti, RIP Shaney, I thought, yes. It's powerful. Protesting police officers using excessive force to the point of death. Graffiti art is another way of taking to the streets.
To see that name when the BLM protests are happening all around me, it really was a bit of a wake-up call, a bit of a reminder of the part that I have to play in the system.
You see, I don't know whether to look at the new part of it as art or is it something that defaces a piece of art. But someone's died, maybe you can look above it and not really take it personally.
It's all a bit surreal. Once I knew it was justice and mental health, I thought, well, that just fits in so well with what we've been trying to do since Shaney passed on in 2010. He was a good young man, had loads of friends, he was very popular. He hated bullies, he hated injustice. Wasn't afraid of doing the right thing and saying the right thing.
He was just a very gregarious, warm, open person, someone who kind of could get in tune with people very quickly, and they warmed to him.
He was 23. He'd just finished his master's at Kingston University, and he wanted to go and do his PhD in America.
In the song that I wrote about him, it says, un morceau de lune, un arc-en-ciel et du soleil. A piece of the moon, a rainbow, and sunshine. That's what Shaney was like. That's who he was.
We just began to notice over the bank holiday weekend in 2010, it became quite unsettled and agitated.
My mum had said to me earlier in the week that I should just kind of be praying for Shaney because, you know, he just didn't seem quite right. She wasn't sure what was going on.
Shaney had never had any mental health issues before, but we could see that he was having his first psychotic episode, and he decided to go as a voluntary patient to the hospital to see what was wrong.
He had a hunch that something terrible was going to happen, which we had no idea at that stage what was going to happen.
What I do remember very vividly is when I came to the hospital ward at Bethlem, it was chaos, very loud shouting. And I thought, this is not a good place to bring somebody who is a bit traumatized, who is not feeling good.
We had no other option, because where else do you go other than to the hospital and a mental health hospital if having mental issues?
You know, we were like, okay, well, he's only in hospital. Everything's going to be okay. And I said, Mom, go home. They have your number and they'll call you if anything.
About 10:30, Omari called me, said, Mom, have they called you from the Bethlem? I said, no. He says there's been an incident.
I was quite baffled by the whole situation because all they said was there'd been an incident. So why is he in intensive care? And that was the only information that we got.
When we went into the family room, I thought it was a bit odd because three policemen were there and they knew who we were, obviously. We didn't know why they were there, and they got up and were sort of looking very uncomfortable. Oh, you know, you're so, it's such a good thing that, you know, somebody was very good at CPR and they resuscitated Shaney. Pardon?
I went to Bethlehem Hospital, and when I went to speak to one of the staff members, the first thing they told me was, we've been told we're not allowed to talk to the press. I was like, what do you mean? Like, why? What happened? But everyone's mouth was shut.
The hospital said that they'd done a brainstem test and that there was no activity and that they wanted to turn off the life support.
You know, everything kind of dawns on you. You didn't have time to breathe. You didn't have time to take it in. It was just happened so quickly. And it was almost like you're standing there watching everything happening and you can't do anything about it.
Never forget, his body just turned cold in like a matter of seconds as soon as they switched off the machine. And then, yeah, that was that.
We'd brought Shaney to a place of safety, care, a place where he'd be looked after. And what we found out was that hospital staff watched, did nothing while they killed Shaney, while the police killed Shaney.
When I first heard about the graffiti, it was quite striking, really. I found it very personally meaningful in a way that I'm probably not used to.
It was such a powerful and such a visual reminder, actually, of the nature of my work and that I work in a system that is racist. I work in a system where black men are overrepresented. And I work in a system where restraints and use of force still happen.
I found it relevant both to my research, but also to the part of me that's an activist. And it really made me feel that I could bring those two things together closer and that it can have a real impact on the ground.
What we know about mental disorder is that there are lots of different causes. It's multifactorial, lots of different risk factors. There's more and more evidence that structural and institutional factors being subjected to discrimination is likely to increase the risk of people developing mental disorder.
It's really about just understanding people who come from different walks of life and trying to be sensitive to their experience.
I feel that the medical staff should be fully equipped to be able to handle any patients that they have. the police can aggravate the situation. So I think there's no place for them there at all.
The question that, you know, people who work in settings with people who are likely to be distressed and agitated and excitable and possibly violent is, do we have the tools and the ways of responding that allow us to respond to someone, to bring the situation down and make things as gentle and calm as possible, instead of pushing people into the other direction, requiring more force and ultimately ending up in a situation where someone loses their life?
My brother died in 2008, Sean Rick. Olaseni Lewis then died, and I found that the same failures had happened as what happened in Sean's case.
I think if people haven't had it happen to somebody in their family, they don't quite believe that it happens in this country, but it does, and people need to wake up to that reality.
The kind of skills that police officers are trained to employ in their job are probably not the same type of skills that are useful in situations where people require support and are in emotional distress.
People hear these stories about these young black men who came into contact with mental health services or had a mental health problem and came into contact with the police, and they end up dead. And that's really concerning, because of course people are going to think, well, hold on a minute, if I've got a mental health problem, and what, you know, even if I try and go for some help, is this what's going to happen to me? Is this what's going to happen to my son?
What lessons have actually been learned? When will there be accountability? Because somebody that is vulnerable has no business being restrained to death by the police.
Olaseni's death has been devastating for people. And likewise with Sean Rigg as well. People feel enormous guilt and shame just to have been associated with something like that happening where we work and where we care for people. It should never have happened. Part of the legacy is that there is now more attention paid to how young black men are treated. I'm hopeful that, you know, when I'm old and retired, the trust already looks different, and the trust will be very different.
Wonderful that somebody all these years later on something that they saw in this place,
I know,
wrote, remember Olaseni.
Yes.
Yeah. How did it make you feel?
Oh, I was happy. I mean, the questions were, you know, about justice and mental health.
I think little pockets of justice are real and that we can cling on to, because there's no real justice.
Yes.
Yeah. It's restorative.
It's like a window's opened into the reality of it, though, isn't it? You live in this bubble prior where you think it's not as bad as it is.
Yeah.
And then you're living it, and it's worse than what you ever thought it was going to be.
I think it sort of makes a kind of melancholy in you, though, that you know that the state is so rubbish.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're dealing with the grief and the loss. Jack died in our community near our house, and all his friends couldn't understand. And we couldn't understand because it was his first mental health crisis. Mm-hmm. And they were like, what have we done? We were all together. We were all looking after each other. It was hard for all of us.
All everybody in different ways, yes.
Yeah. Tommy died 5 years ago, and you met these wonderful women a year and a half ago. And I just think this whole process is so traumatizing and upsetting and difficult. You know, it is like that when you're grieving anyway, but to lose someone in those circumstances is different, because there's a real unfairness to it. And I think meeting other people who've been through that and see the injustice is something special about that, and you only get that from other people who've gone through the same kind of thing.
Mm. Feels like you're my sisters.
Yes. Yeah.
Because you understand me.
Yeah. We have each other.
Yes. Yeah. Your loved one dies in state custody. You genuinely believe you're going to find out what happened.
And I think that's the thing, it's almost by accident that you find out that actually you should have support or you should have legal representation. I think when Tommy died, you know, people are throwing these words around, inquest. I have, you know, you have no idea what this stuff is.
You must do what they don't want you to do.
Mm.
They want you to shut up.
Yeah,
really? But collectively, our voice is so powerful and we need it for us. That's why it's important to tell our stories and to bring awareness of the injustice.
Yeah, that's it.
At the beginning, it was me being an artist and this is my artwork, whereas now it's just like, just kind of a little part of everyone else who's involved with it. One thing that art's good at is the idea of empathy. If you see the world through someone else's eyes, you kind of realise that your own view of the world is not the only one.
That particular place, it's a place where a massive trauma happened within our family. And seeing the artwork with the graffiti on, actually, to me, brought the artwork to life, gave the artwork a sense of realness.
I'm a bit sort of old-fashioned, you know. You know, graffiti, you know, but wow. In the last few years, mindset has changed because this is a whole new conversation that's going to come about as a result of that graffiti.
Stories like Shaney's and the Lewis family's story, they stay in the community, they don't go away. The best thing you can do is address them and talk about them and embrace them as a community. It's just this really great example of why art should be in public spaces and why the public have every right to feel ownership over that work. And when they do, you actually open up that artwork to shift and change and become more than what it was originally meant for.
Thank you, whoever did it. You did it so neatly and respectfully. I love that. And thank you, Mark, for the original questions. I hope your questions have been answered.
Shaney, on dirait pas comme ça. Shaney, oh oh, pas destiné pour ça. Un morceau de lune et une arc-en-ciel et du soleil. Oh la Shaney, oh, on t'a mis dans la terre avec des larmes et des fleurs, c'est pas vrai. Morceau de lune. Ciel et du soleil dans ton cœur. On t'a mis dans la terre avec des larmes et des fleurs. C'est pas vrai. C'est pas vrai. C'est pas vrai.